Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for bringing us to another day where we can come together and we can praise your name and we can learn from you. As we open up your word and begin to discuss these topics, we ask that you enlighten our minds and that you will help us to settle into these truths that they might sanctify us. We ask for the Holy Spirit now, as we know that we cannot understand these without him. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Are you ready? You don't have to get up here. I'm going to do the board work for you, but you read the five verses and you tell me what's in those five verses. And we're going to go through chapter 4 real quickly because we have already did that. And then we're going to do chapter 5 here, and then chapter 6 here, and then we're going to do Patrick's technique and erase some lines.
What?
You'll see. Loud and clear for the microphone.
First one. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, unto all people, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. I thought it good to show the signs and wonders that the high God hath wrought toward you. How great are his signs, and how mighty are his wonders, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion from generation to generation. I, Nebuchadnezzar, was at rest in my house and flourishing in my palace. I saw a dream which made me afraid, and the thoughts upon my bed and the visions of my head troubled me.
Okay, he has about 4 or 5 waymar or characteristics to put in place, and if he doesn't get them right away, we'll help him. But what are the characteristics that you see? It's a bit early. Okay. We're going to place this at 9/11 because he's troubled. And he's the only one that gets off on this. So don't, he isn't our example. We're putting troubled there at 9/11 because the kings of the earth are troubled by the east wind striking, right? He's at rest in his palace. And rest is a symbol of what's taking place here when the latter rain takes place. And he's in his palace. We have kings that are in their palace right here. And he sends this message out to Babylon, right? To the whole world. This is worldwide. This is a characteristic of this history too, or of this way, Mark. So what are we forgetting? Yes, this is the empowerment of the first angel's message and the dream visions. Okay, Brother Daniel, 5 verses. Pardon me, wait a second.
There's 2 things. One, he's in present tense describing something in the first 3 verses, and then we got into 2 verses where he's describing past tense. My question is, when we're placing the first 3 verses, how are we placing these ones as well? Because we know that when you get to the dream, he's troubled, he's at rest. You know, all of these characteristics put us at 9/11. Are the first 3 also placing us at 9/11 because of the worldwide?
Worldwide.
They're 2 different parts of the history, and they're coming together. I just wonder about the
signs.
It's
the beginning and the end.
He says, how great are his signs?
So what about?
Signs and wonders are, these are the signs of the time. 9/11 is a sign. I didn't know if we're putting this.
Signs and wonders.
Yeah,
making us know signs and wonders. But you notice the first 3 verses are also the last verses in the chapter. He has an opening statement in the... Okay. So it's like.
Isn't the sign that wonders that lighten the earth with his glory?
No, I don't think so. Maybe. Signs and wonders are the waymarks, but maybe that's what. Okay, so we're not figuring out what the distinction is about present tense and past tense, right?
Therefore made I a decree to bring in all the wise men of Babylon before me, that they might make known unto me the interpretation of the dream. Then came in the magicians and astrologers and the Chaldeans and the soothsayers, and I told the dream before them, but they did not make known unto me the interpretation thereof. But at the last Daniel came in before me, whose name was Belshazzar, according to the name of my God, and in whom is the spirit of the holy gods. And before him I hold the dream, saying, O Belshazzar, master of the magicians, because I know that the spirit of the holy gods is in thee, and no secret trouble thee. Tell me the vision of my dream that I have seen, and the interpretation thereof. Thus were the vision of my head in my bed. I saw, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height thereof was great.
So what are the characteristics? Easy one, verse 6.
Gathering.
The decree.
There's a decree.
Yeah.
Five.
Trouble, no.
No, nope. Troubled okay. Is up here.
And fear.
Okay. I was going to say there's a distinction. There's a dream associated with a fray, and there's a vision associated with trouble.
Yeah, that's what ties it in. Is Pharaoh had a dream that troubled him, and he's had a dream that troubled him back in chapter 2, too.
Him afraid, and then that vision that troubled him.
Yeah, I'm relating to those the same thing.
I think the past and present tenses help tie us into what happens in the story of Joseph, where the butler recounts the old past. He remembers what happened with Joseph, and he recounts this dream and what took place. Because Nebuchadnezzar is saying he's remembering the old past. He might be doing that, but anyways. Might be a solution.
Other characteristics, Brother Daniel, in those five verses you read?
Number four.
Verse seven. The number four.
Wise in verse six.
Gathering in verse six.
A gathering.
Wise men.
Wise.
Gathering.
Gathering. Not enough room, huh? But I'll just keep going straight down below. Wise, gathering.
Name change.
Are you seeing these?
Yeah.
Name change. I'm just going to put name. For name change. So he makes a decree. The wise men are all brought in, but there's a distinction between the wise and the foolish. What's the distinction?
If he is asking for interpretation, it's not a type of increase of knowledge.
Yeah, he's asking for an increase of knowledge. Increase of knowledge is usually over here.
Okay.
But this would be a sprinkling,
yeah.
Probably. So you could put that under rest.
The spirit?
Yeah, that's the distinction. Daniel has the spirit.
Mostly he was brought in at last. He pointed it out that at last it's a different time than 9-11.
When he's brought in. Yeah, but they're called here. Right? And he's the last one to come in, so he'll be coming in there. what are we forgetting? Anything? My brother.
A secret? Or hiding? A secret is a secret.
You skip in?
Yes.
A secret.
Where's a secret?
Verse 9.
Yeah, but what are we saying about it? About a secret?
There's a secret marked there as a symbol. What
verse? 9.
But okay, so there's a secret. Have we got other information about a secret?
The hide. Just I would connect it to the hiding, but
yeah.
The secret is part of the narrative.
All right, secret.
The thing that troubles him is the thing that doesn't trouble Daniel.
The thing that troubles him.
It's the secret. He says, no secret troubleth thee, but it troubles
okay,
the thing.
Okay, so take it off.
No, I don't know what it means.
It's an evil secret.
No, it's a good
one. We'll erase it later.
Okay.
Sister Tiffany, 11 through 15.
The tree grew and was strong,
and the height thereof reached unto heaven, and the sight thereof to the end of all the earth. The leaves thereof were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and in it was meat for all. The beasts of the field had shadow under it, and the fowls of the heaven dwelt in the boughs thereof, and all flesh was fed of it. I saw in the visions of my head upon my bed, and behold, a watcher and a holy one came down from heaven. He cried aloud and said thus, who down the tree and cut off his branches, shake off his leaves and scatter his fruit. Let the beasts get away from under it and the fowls from his branches. Nevertheless, leave the stump of his roots in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass, in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts in the grass of the earth.
What's in those verses?
Scattering.
Holy One came down. Verse 13.
Divine symbol.
Pardon me?
Divine symbol coming down. This is
something. Which verse?
13.
Brother Jeff, I have a question. It says that Daniel was brought in at last. Does that mean that Nebuchadnezzar had to repeat the dream over again, telling him Daniel his dream? Can we assume that, or is that wrong? Because he first of all told it to his wise men, and then at last Daniel was brought in. So are we assuming that Daniel was present there, but he just wasn't there in front of the king? Or did the king have to repeat the dream to him again so he could...
I don't know.
See that a doubling?
I don't know. So 13 and 14, we were there. What's 13 and 14? Sister Allison says it's the second angel's message.
Yeah, so watch your holy one came down.
Okay, why is it the second angel's message?
Comes down.
So there's the first, so there's the third, so there's the fourth.
Yeah.
I might know why it's the second.
I see.
Because there's two.
What's the tree?
The tree's the church.
The tree's the church.
Oh, no.
In this context, what's Daniel going to tell Nebuchadnezzar the tree is?
It's his kingdom.
It's
him.
It's him, but it's his kingdom.
But
we're asking Allison here. What's Daniel ultimately going to tell Nebuchadnezzar that tree represents? Don't read ahead. You know this story.
Yeah, okay. I'm just looking. It's the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar.
And that is? Is that the church?
God.
He's the king of?
Babylon.
Okay, and what's going to happen to the tree?
Cut down.
It's going to cut down. So when that tree is cut down, what happens?
Babylon
has fallen.
Okay.
What's the message of the second angel?
Okay.
Babylon has fallen. But this could be the message of the fourth angel, Revelation 18, because the same message. But there's a holy one that comes down out of heaven. This is the fall of Babylon, right?
In verse 14, he says that he cried aloud.
Yeah, crying aloud. Babylon has fallen. Right? So how do we put that in here? This is the dream. Where do we necessarily plug that in here? Where do we plug in this?
We put the arrow down.
Where?
Pointing at 9-11.
Because he's explaining a dream. And the dream we have to take, we're describing the history of Daniel and Nebuchadnezzar's interaction here. The dream is a secondary issue. Where do we plug the dream in at? The midnight cry. Why?
Because that's what he's speaking about, that time period. That's what's going to happen.
Okay, it's because we know in advance the fulfillment of the dream. So you're going to put the angel coming down here?
Yes. That's where I have written in my
notes. Okay, well. Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to let her get away with that.
Mm-hmm. Brother Jeff, I believe I have a verse that can connect the secret with hiding.
The secret with hiding, okay.
It's 1 Samuel 19, 1 and 2.
1 Samuel 19, 1 and 2.
Can I read it?
Please.
And Saul spake to Jonathan his son and to all his servants that they should kill David. But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted much in David, and Jonathan told David, saying, Saul, my father, seeketh to kill thee. Now therefore, I pray thee, take heed to thyself until the morning, and I bid in a secret place and hide thyself. Mm. So I believe it can be a connection, isn't it?
Amen.
So when Saul seeking to kill him?
At 9/11, when people see that alive.
Typically, from this history here is where Saul's trying to kill David, is in this history. Saul dies here. Saul's dead. But I mean, maybe there's a secondary application, but Saul dies here at the Witch of Endor with spiritual formation, right?
So then it would be okay to put the secret back there in 89 because he was given the dream that was a secret unto him before he was troubled by it.
Before or right?
Right, but you
simultaneously,
have to
you get the dream and you get troubled.
Dream and then you're troubled.
We apply Saul as persecuting David in 1989 and 9/11 in the one story where there's a harp playing, but he's playing the harp and Saul throws the javelin at him, and then later on we apply his death at 9/11. But all the stories in between we haven't actually gone through and applied. So this story might actually put us in 9/11 contextually.
No, maybe if it's a different line, but from here to here is the wilderness of En Gedi, and it includes all that history.
Wasn't there a secret alliance?
But those histories repeats and enlarges upon each other. The whole history probably isn't just placed there.
Secret alliance
that went on with Reagan.
The secret coming together of the world powers that want to kill David. They want to cause Israel to know more. Be a nation.
But what I mean to say is that he said, and I bid in a secret place and hide yourself. And I'm just trying to connect that you stay hiding like to a secret place.
Yeah, that verse doesn't.
They are connected.
So even with.
David was hiding here.
But without the context of the story, you can see that secret and hiding can be one symbol. That's what he was trying to say, I think.
Yeah. Not a problem. I'm getting that.
1 Samuel 25.
Wait a second. What? It's 1 Samuel 19 what?
Yeah.
19, what's the verse?
1 and 2.
Let's look at that. First Samuel 19, 1 and 2. And Saul spake to Jonathan his son and to all his servants that they should kill David. Sounds like a death decree when a king speaks. But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted much in David. And Jonathan told David, saying, Saul, my father, seeketh to kill thee. Now therefore, I pray thee, take heed to hide thyself until the morning, and abide in a secret place, and hide thyself. Okay, Michael, what are you going to say?
Oh, I was just saying that 1 Samuel 25 is the same history. Saul's not dead yet, persecuting David, but the whole thing starts at 9/11. So I'm saying that maybe there are other stories that repeat and enlarge that are pulled out of that history. But in a general way, overall, Saul's trying to kill David from 1989. But each of these stories are repeating and enlarging upon ours.
Okay, we'll leave that unresolved, but we'll acknowledge secret, hide, interchangeable at that level.
We know that Haman secretly counted the days trying to figure out what was the right timing to kill the Jews too, and that we know that began in 9/11 too.
Okay, verses 11 through 15, did we put everything in place? What's the two bands? A doubling. Where do we put them? Okay, double bands.
Why would you put it on that side of it? Why wouldn't you put it in the binding off?
Because it's double.
Isn't it double between?
You want to put the double bands here? The trees cut down back here, or is the tree going to get cut down here?
Isn't it like a point in time, a period of time, midnight to midnight cry?
Where would everyone else put it? Would you put it at the midnight cry or at midnight?
Midnight cry.
Oh,
Okay.
This is the United States, majority rules. Change from republic to a democracy. What else is in there?
Are you putting the Watcher and the Holy One? That's your arrow?
Yeah, that's the Watcher and the Holy One.
Okay. And the Loud Cry.
Oh, yeah, Loud Cry.
And what?
The Holy One. Loud Cry, cries loud. And
scattering.
There's dew of heaven.
Yes.
And scattering the fruit.
And a lot of fruit.
Pardon me?
And fruit, much fruit. Fruit thereof much.
Scattering much fruit.
So there's a fruit. There's a first fruit offering offered at the midnight cry. We know of the priest. That's the first fruit.
And they get scattered?
I'm just saying that if you're applying this.
Well, no. Sister White is clear that at the Sunday law, Adventists get scattered. So there's a scattering of the priests here.
Okay.
They're the fruit.
They're scattering of the priest.
But if there's a scattering of the 144,000 here and you do the fractal.
Is there one? A scattering of the one?
The one that Sister White talks about here is a physical scattering, like we're going to get persecuted and moved around the world. So maybe something like that's going on here.
Scattering of the animals too.
What?
There's a scattering of the animals too.
And what would, well, let's not go there. Is that everything from those verses?
Brother Jeff, I think there's a distinction between the dream coming in and then the dream becoming a vision. I don't think we've ever really looked at that,
We're not going to this morning, though. I want to try to get through chapter 4 and into chapter 5. I have no insight whatsoever on what the distinction between the dream and the vision is in here.
In terms of vision, he says he cried a lot. In the vision, the Holy One came down and then he cried aloud.
I think he saw that in his dream.
I'm sure that it begins as a dream and then becomes a vision.
I don't know what that means.
I think they're interchangeable.
Yeah, they're the same.
I think there are other verses that show that dream and vision are interchangeable.
Yeah, but just remember that the Lord says that when he's going to reveal himself to a prophet, he's going to either do it through dreams or visions.
Is it your turn to read, my sister? Yes.
Real quick, Leviticus 26:19, we have the breaking of pride of the power, iron and brass. Where are we placing that?
Leviticus what?
26:19, and I will break the pride of your power, and I will make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass.
Manasseh.
Is that Manasseh? So that's a little bit different when we see that iron and brass represented, but that's okay. That we put him at 19.
Iron and brass represents bondage and you know, persecution. The iron furnace of Egypt.
Oh, yeah. That's when your persecution starts in earnest. For the priest, sorry.
Yeah, but Manasseh, same thing. He gets carried into captivity into Babylon.
He's in earnest. So the priests are a down payment in one type of what the other one's
no,
going
Manasseh on. Would be back here.
I know, but...
But you can put the four in here. Manasseh can be here, too.
I'm saying,
but I don't know why you put
cry.
It over here yet. I don't get that.
But you are admitting it is there.
No, I'm saying that iron and brass are iron and brass, but where you, at this point, the only place we have applying Manasseh is here and here, so I don't get it.
Okay.
Couldn't iron and brass be some sort of reference to Greece and Rome? Some sort of bondage under Greece and Rome spiritually or their systems?
Okay. Yeah, the...
Because it says in Deuteronomy also this is the iron, heaven's obey as iron, and or one way or the other, but iron and brass.
It's in the Bible, it's reversed.
Brass.
One time it says your heaven shall be as iron and the ground below you is brass, and another time it says it just the opposite.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you have these bands.
Okay. This isn't going as fast as I thought. Did we? It's cut down. This here in the Millerite history is the second angel's message, is it not? I mean, the midnight cry is the empowerment of the second angel's message. So take note, that's what's illustrated there in verse 13 and 14, second angel's message. Okay. Yep.
Last his heart be changed from man's, and let a beast heart be given unto him, and let seven times pass over him. This matter is by the decree of the watchers, and the demand by the word of the holy ones, to the intent that the living may know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and gives it to whomsoever he will, and setteth up over it the basest of men. This dream our Nebuchadnezzar hath seen. Now thou, O Belshazzar, declare the interpretation thereof, forasmuch as all the wise men of my kingdom are not able to make known unto me the interpretation, but thou art able, for the spirit of the holy gods is with thee, is in thee. Then Daniel, whose name was Belshazzar, was astonished for 1 hour, and his thoughts troubled him. The king spake and said, Belshazzar, let not the dream or the interpretation thereof trouble thee. Belshazzar answered and said, My lord, the dream be to them that hate thee, and the interpretation thereof to thine enemies.
Verse 20.
The tree thou sawest, which grew and was strong, whose height reached unto the heaven, and the sight thereof to all the earth.
Okay, so what do you have in there, Sister Allison? What do you have in verse 16?
We have a name change.
No, verse 16.
Yeah. Oh, his heart changed.
A heart change.
His countenance.
Where are you going to put that?
Midnight.
Heart change.
Sorry. At the.
Why is it midnight cry?
Pardon me.
That'd be at the binding off. The heart changed?
No, it isn't.
Changed the heart. It's
who is it? Who's getting their heart changed?
Nebuchadnezzar,
because he's going to be living like a beast for seven times. And this happens to him when the tree is cut down right here, when the Holy One comes down. Brother Michael.
Have you placed the heart, the other heart change from up that's represented on the chart, where the lion's heart is changed into a man's heart? Is this the same thing? I mean, it's exactly the opposite, but I'm wondering if these two things go together, if they replace that. No?
I haven't. I don't know.
It's just weird that it's the same kingdom, same king. Exactly
their his visage changes here. So there's something about a heart change going on.
Seven times?
Okay. And what verse are you in?
16.
All right. I'm going to put seven times out here. Verse 17, Sister Allison.
Decree.
There's a decree.
A decree. What else?
There's there's a setting up of the
Acknowledging that God is the one that does it.
Well, the Holy One, like there's a watcher again. So that's not the second angel.
So yeah, it's the same watcher. And verse 18.
Yes, it's dream.
There's acknowledgement again that Daniel has the spirit. He's the wise. It comes out of this history.
He's asking.
So that would be the Levites, right?
It's what?
The Levites in that time period.
Well, maybe, but what I think it's emphasizing is that one class has the oil, the spirit, and the other class doesn't. The four Chaldeans can't interpret it because they don't have the spirit.
And the one with the oil is being asked to declare what he knows, so it's an inquiry. I guess if that's...
What verse is it again? Do you look saying it?
Verse 18.
Verse 18. There's an inquiry.
He's saying. Well, he's not asking the question, but he's saying, declare unto me what you know.
Declare the interpretation.
Spirit. Yeah.
Is that an inquiry?
He's requesting him to declare.
No, Henry says that's not an inquiry.
Yeah, it's not a question. That's what he's saying, but he's asking.
But to me, it's an inquiry, because even in Matthew 25, to say that the foolish virgins? Give us of your oil. That's the inquiry that we use for our primary point of reference, and
it's
kind of like a command or a request, but it's a question. So this might be a question too. Explain it to me.
Explain what?
Oh.
That's what he's doing. So are we going to put that up there though? Is it too vague?
Where are you seeing this?
Verse 18.
At the basic level, he has the holy oil because the holy oil is the spirit. So he says, wise virgin who has the oil, give me your interpretation.
Declare unto me the interpretation.
Declare unto me the words of God. That's so, you know.
It's the same kind of request.
It's really the exact same thing as Matthew 25.
The interpretation could also be put as a prediction. Predict the dream.
Yes, but where are we going to put the request to declare it? Here?
Just declare it, the midnight cry.
He's declaring it, but where's the inquiry?
Before.
Midnight.
Pardon me?
Midnight.
Why is it? Right here is where he's saying, now Daniel, declare it to me.
Well, because at last Daniel comes to him, it says at last, and I think that's where we put it. We'll put it at midway, not at midnight.
Well, yeah, but that's not the, it's the argument, but okay, I'll put it in here.
The loud cry is the declaration, so there has to be a question before the declaration.
There's no E.
When you are going to see the prediction, they're not going to believe in us, I believe. So after it happens, they're going to ask for us the interpretation of this, isn't it?
Maybe. Say, I didn't follow that.
So at midnight, you're going to do the prediction. They're not believing us. After it
Who's not believing us?
The government.
Yeah, okay.
And after it happens, they're going to ask for us, oh, what you said? So what's the interpretation of that, isn't it?
He's saying there's an inquiry at midnight.
The inquirement is after the event, at midnight cry, I believe.
Well, definitely there's an inquiry here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But what's bringing Daniel into midnight is Nebuchadnezzar, and he's saying, I know you have the oil, and they don't. Tell it to me. He's asking for the prediction right here, isn't he? Mm-hmm. But there's going to be another inquiry.
Why would he ask before?
Because he's asking to explain the dream, but the dream's not going to get fulfilled in history till here.
But how does he know that he has the Spirit of God at midnight?
From Daniel chapter 2.
From his whole life with Daniel.
Yeah, but in our time.
Oh, how does he know he has...
How does...
Nebuchadnezzar...
How does someone in our time know...
That God's people have...
That God's people have God's spirit.
At midnight.
At midnight.
Before
Before it is fulfilled.
Because they're watching
the Because of 9/11, because of the prediction that we've already talked about Islam and what's been happening. We've been putting the whole pieces together from 1989 to 9/11 on. And actually, Brother Jeff has been talking about Islam way before that time. It's just kind of happened exactly the way he said it.
Yeah, but they will awake to that when
we'll
it's
leave
fulfilled.
That. Yeah.
That was Daniel's point, that when you get to the midnight cry, an event has already actually happened, and thus they're able to be awakened to the fact that there
then
are these people proclaiming this message. Mm-hmm. Whereas at midnight, there's not really an event that we're aware of at the moment.
Well, we're predicting that Islam's going to hit again, right?
Yeah.
We've seen that Islam has hit at 9/11. We've seen Islam involved in 1989. So we basically will be predicting that Islam is going to be continued, annoying the whole world. So
but
yeah,
but the inquiry will not happen after. Not before.
But I think it's two different inquiries.
Probably.
Daniel here is being asked to give the prediction. Here he's being asked to explain it or something.
Yeah.
But I mean, he's being, I don't know, I'm not sure if it's an inquiry, but this is part of the distinction between the wise and the foolish, right? The four Chaldeans have fallen here. He's the only one standing. He's got the Holy Spirit in him. Explain it to me in advance of it happening. It happens here. Mm-hmm. Anyway, let's move beyond that so we can...
So, I'm going to say this
again, but it's a dream. Somebody can have a dream, but then when they start seeing it, fulfilling it, doesn't it become more like of a vision? I mean, I don't know.
I think you're stuck with words.
I'm thinking of Greece now. I'm thinking about Alexander the Great, that he had a dream. The high priest had also a dream, and then they seen it fulfilling it. And then it became a reality, so...
I don't think when it's a reality, it's a vision. I think it's just a reality.
Sister, did you read these verses? You were the reader, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What's verse 19?
There's, he's astonished. And there's
stonied.
A
stonied.
And I
is it
astonied
or
astonied? It's astonied. It's either or.
Daniel's
stonied.
Daniel corrected me on the way out, but I forgot how the other Daniel. I forgot how he pronounced it. Okay, so he's astonished for 1 hour.
There's also a name change.
There's a name change.
That's 1 hour.
And he's still troubled.
Troubled
him.
And his thoughts troubled him.
No, he's saying, Daniel, you don't need to be troubled.
Right.
So, where's the 1 hour?
Astonied.
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 Yeah. Yeah. That's what I was
Astonied.
Just doing, too.
Okay, so this is the 1 hour, right?
The lips, too.
Yeah. And in here... Daniel is.
That is also a name change.
Is it trouble?
He's troubled.
A name change. No, he's not troubled.
The king perceives him to be troubled. No, it says
his thoughts troubled.
Oh, really?
Yeah, his thoughts troubled.
Oh, okay. I'm looking at where it says be not troubled.
So
okay, so there's trouble.
In haste, trouble.
So what's trouble?
And the Aramaic it says is to terrify, hasten.
No, 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 no. What's trouble prophetically?
Oh.
Sunday law or midnight cry.
Abuse.
It's the east wind, isn't it? Isn't Islam the one that angers the nations and distresses the nations? This is what troubles the kings at 9/11.
Yeah.
So are we putting that trouble right there? Because if we are, we're putting the symbol of Islam right there at midnight.
I don't think it's Islam.
No.
Okay, what is it?
Well, it's Daniel. God's people aren't fearing Islam, right? In this history. It's
no, but this is... They're talking about the first part where... Here, when he's calling him in, Nebuchadnezzar's troubled.
But Daniel's fearing for the king, not for himself. No.
This is
no,
Daniel.
No, it says,
troubled.
Then Daniel, whose name was Belteshazzar, was astonished for 1 hour, and his thoughts... Oh, it is Daniel. His thoughts troubled him.
Yeah.
Okay. So
it's because when you make a prediction,
it's the crisis at midnight. It's
you're
the bitterness or whatever.
By it, yeah.
But look what he says, my Lord, the dream be to them that hate thee.
Yeah,
so he's foreseeing
the
trouble was going to come upon Nebuchadnezzar, so he's trouble for the king. I don't think that he's trouble for himself.
Is it the Mara?
Mara. Anyway, what else is in there? We got them all, but except one.
The tree.
Enemies.
Yeah,
it's
like
about
the
enemies.
The king's fate.
Hate.
Who's the enemies? And who are they hating?
The kings hate. The 10 kings hate God's people. Like
no, it isn't about God's people. This is oh king, this is for your enemies and those that hate you. This is about people that hate Nebuchadnezzar.
Mm-hmm.
Islam?
His hands against every man.
Okay, so... So it is about Islam, okay. But the other thing I wanted to put in there before we move on is... The king spake.
Did he?
Oh, the speaking.
Which
right there would be a speaking, sure.
Might be a decree.
Mm-hmm.
Where did he speak?
In verse 19.
The king spake, it said.
There's something interesting about the troubling is that Daniel's told by the king, nothing troubles you, no secrets do. And then Daniel, in a different kind of way, is troubled. His thoughts are troubled. Because he's not troubled because he doesn't understand. The king says, there's nothing that escapes your understanding. He wasn't not understanding. And then the king says, don't be troubled by the dream, just tell me what's up. So the troubled's being used in a different way when in relation to Daniel.
It's the troubling that Isaiah had right before he got the coal touched to his lips. It was troubling because of the burden of the message. He realized how great the enormity of this burden was, and it humbled him.
Nebuchadnezzar was troubled because he didn't understand, and Daniel is troubled because he understands.
This is saying Eli and Samuel, when Eli told Samuel, tell me the dream, tell me the vision, and that was the Mara vision.
Samuel was a little hesitant.
Same when Daniel got the vision.
Samuel was
once ran away.
Okay, so the reason I have those mulans under trouble and inquiry is there's still some stuff unresolved about those. Verse 20, what do you have in verse 20, Sister Allison?
The tree, it grew strong, it reached into heaven.
What does that mean?
There's a tree at the midnight cry running up high, and its roots down into the earth.
It's the Tower of Babel.
Wow, this is
okay, we're stretching. What's the last part of the verse say? Last part of the verse, we can put something on it.
Inside?
The sight of it's through the whole earth.
Worldwide.
Okay, right in here, so the whole world's going to start looking at it. Yeah, the plowing for the 11th hour workers, the Levites are going to be
coming on board.
So, Earth. I don't know how to. I don't know what the label to put on that. Brother Henry, you want to read the next five verses? Go ahead.
With this tree. I just thought that there's a striking resemblance here with the United States. Daniel's speaking to the United States and saying, at one point, you were a haven of all nations. Everyone could come to you for protection and freedom, and now you've come to the point where you're dictating the consciousness of men, and God's going to cut you. I just thought that's a striking resemblance with what's taking place here.
That's what I see, too.
Yeah. This is
at that point.
The United States going down.
I was just kind of wondering if that reach unto heaven could also have a special significance when you especially take a look at the Tower of Babel. They, too, were trying to build up their structure unto heaven.
There's a ladder that reaches to heaven.
But this lofty tree is a good thing. It's like a big, wonderful place for the creatures to dwell. And he's saying, you were that once, but God's going to cut you down because you've become like Babel, proud and lifted up.
It goes Revelation 18:5, where it says, the sins have reached
unto heaven.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Same as the cup filling up.
Cup filling up. And that's what's happening here.
Yeah.
It's filled up its cup, it's reached unto heaven, and it's cut down. Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't know how to put that on the board, but we acknowledge it. Next five verses.
Whose leaves were fair, and the fruit thereof much, and in it was meat for all, under which the beasts of the field dwelt. Okay, upon whose branches the fowls of the heaven have had their habitation. It is thou, O king, that art grown and become strong, for thy greatness is grown and reached unto heaven, and thy dominion to the end of the earth.
Sounds like the United States to me, but keep reading.
Yeah.
And whereas the king saw the watcher and the holy one coming down from heaven and saying, hew the tree down and destroy it, yet leave the stump of the roots thereof in the earth, even with a band of iron and brass, in the tender grass of the field, and let it be wet with the dew of heaven, and let his portion be with the beasts of the field, till seven times pass over him. This is the interpretation, O king, and this is the decree of the Most High, which is come upon my lord the king, that they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and they shall make thee to eat grass as oxen, and they shall wet thee with the dew of heaven, and seven times shall pass over thee till thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomsoever he will.
Okay, what do you got there? You already got the decree.
cutting down of this tree.
Where is he going to dwell when his tree's going down?
In the field.
In the field.
That's where. Who with is he going to do? Dwell
with the beasts.
The beasts. The ashes. This is him coming into relationship with the one world order, right?
There's an ass marked there. Because when
there's a what?
There's an ass. The beast of the field, in chapter 5, it refers to them as the ass, right? So we can mark that at that point. Yeah, let me find it real quick.
Yeah.
Is there a difference between an earthly decree and a divine or heavenly decree?
I'm sure there is.
It sounds like a judgment, like a close of probation in some ways.
That's what's going on here, right? The United States is filling its cup. The United States fills its cup, Sister White says more than once, at the Sunday Law, the United States has filled the cup of its probationary time, and national apostasy is followed by national ruin. But this is a fractal of that. So the United States here is going down. It's heading down, going to climax here. But in here, they're going to be form a relationship with the globalist. They're going to dwell with the beasts.
On the beast point, it says in verse 21 of chapter 5, and he was driven from the sons of men, and his heart was made like the beasts, and his dwelling was with the wild asses. They fed him. Anyways, that's the point. Wild asses.
Okay.
That's Islam at the midnight.
Yeah, but what's it mean that he's dwelling with the wild asses? Is there an alliance formed between the United States and Islam in here?
No idea.
No, it's just that.
And if you kept reading.
They're all together. All the players are together.
All the players are together. The beast, the globalist, Islam, and the United States in this history. That would work, but is that what's being specified? I don't know.
In the light of the sanctuary or the temple, when the temple was destroyed, eventually what ended up in the place where the temple was the place of the Jews, or not the Muslims to worship. That's also a sign of the Islam.
Sister Pam, 5 verses, por favor.
Okay. And whereas they commanded to leave.
Where are you?
Is it 26?
Really? Okay, we've made it that far. Sorry. Yep.
And whereas they commanded to leave the stump of the tree root, thy kingdom shall be sure unto thee. After that thou shalt have known that the heavens do rule. Wherefore, O king, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee, and break off thy sins by righteousness, and thine iniquities by showing mercy to the poor. If it may be a lengthening of thy tranquility. All this came upon the king Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. The king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom, by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty?
So, where are we going to put the 12 months? At midnight. No, it's a period of time. Where are we going to put it?
9/11 to the midnight cry?
9/11 to the midnight cry?
Yeah, the 12th month is that last portion there.
Doesn't Nebuchadnezzar sound like he's making an inquiry about his majesty and his greatness?
But you're saying this is the 12th month?
That's the 12th month, yeah.
Based upon
all the 1 month there. And you have the 11-12.
11-12 with the disciples.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Replacing Judas. Okay, what were you saying, Tanya?
Oh, I was just saying that Nebuchadnezzar is making an inquiry about his majesty and his greatness in verse 30.
What is verse 27, though? Where is Daniel in verse 27 when he's saying this to the king?
He's giving him advice.
Yeah, he's giving him advice, but where is he in this scenario? Where is...
Break off thy sins in 9/11.
No, where is he?
9/11?
Midnight cry.
He's at the midnight cry. And what is he... What is the...
Showing mercy to the poor.
What is that? It's an altar call, isn't it? Break off thy sins. Mm-hmm. How else would you say that?
Repent.
Repent. Where is that?
Conviction of sin.
It's the first test here. Right? Isn't that the first test?
Yep.
Fear God.
Yeah.
Break off thy sins.
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know, break sins. And you're sure that's...
Repentance.
That is, this is, I'm going to put number one for the first test, even though it should be over here. But you're sure that Daniel's saying this to him at the midnight cry, huh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. And this here is the 1 month.
I'm not so sure.
Why? I just wanted to ask.
Who wanted to ask? What?
Why is it the midnight cry?
Yeah, why?
Yeah, because Tyler said so, and no one challenged him.
Because he's doing this after he was astonished. This is the same context that he was just... He was astonished for 1 hour, and then at the end of the 1 hour, he gives him this monologue, and this is what he tells him.
I think that wherever all of this stuff is taking place, somehow... Nebuchadnezzar breaks off his sins by righteousness for a period until he exalts himself again. So,
For one year.
So my point is that Nebuchadnezzar, the king of the United States, is not hearing the message until midnight cry. But then we have him back at 9/11, having already heard the message, and now breaking off his sins by righteousness until the midnight cry when he's cut down.
So you can say this is 1 year too?
The
12 months, okay.
It seems...
All right, I was thinking it was two different things in my mind. Go ahead.
I don't know. It seems... it just seems strange that at 9/11, he already has this knowledge before he has the knowledge. He has this knowledge of his sin.
You're saying Daniel's telling him here,
yeah,
break off your sins by righteousness, and a year later he forgets about it and it happens to him.
Yeah, if we're applying...
But Daniel gets brought in here and he explains the dream, and as he's explaining the dream, after he's astonished for 1 hour, he's explaining the dream down here. So how can we project it back here?
Mm-hmm. Because fear God and give him glory. Nebuchadnezzar ended up giving himself glory, not to God.
You know.
And that's fear God giving glory is second age of message.
Fear God is first.
Right.
Give him glory is second.
That's what we're saying, 9/11.
Either it's a repeat and enlarge, and we have to go back like what we're saying right now, or you have to go forward, and I think you run into issues. It seems like there's a little bit of issues either way, but going forward is a little bit harder.
I have no problem going back. My point is that if we pull the 12 months back to 9/11, we should pull the message given to Nebuchadnezzar back to 9/11 also. That's my point. Because the 12 months is directly in relation to that message that's given. He reacts to that message for a period of 12 months.
Everyone understand what he's saying?
Mm-hmm.
There's a chronological issue with this.
And how is the issue resolved? In my mind, I explained it once, not today. You probably forgot it. Not a problem. How is it resolved? It's where I started a couple days back. No. Is that this is an illustration of the everlasting gospel, and Nebuchadnezzar represents the wise virgins down here. And here, with Belshazzar, this is the foolish virgins. And in the very same night, Belshazzar is going to die. So you got chapter 5 to also give you second witness to where you're putting this structure, because they both are going to manifest right here. And then they're going to manifest here at a fractal level. Do you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So chapter 5 is what gives us the license to say that this is repeat and enlarge, because you have to maintain this structure within this structure, because they're the same story. It's the story of the wise and foolish virgins.
So back to my point, I only have one contention with what was being said, and it's that the last thing you wrote, fear sins.
Break off your sins.
Break off your sins. What I was saying is that I think that would go at the beginning of the 12 months.
And that would still be the right place, first message.
It would still be the right place.
First test. And I'm going to just put it, does everyone follow that?
Mm-hmm.
Break. Okay.
I'd agree, but I don't think there wasn't a message given to Nebuchadnezzar at 9/11, though.
No.
But I guess in a spiritual sense there was, but
that's
in terms of
dream.
A three-step testing,
world.
but there nobody gave him a message.
No, because he has a dream. He doesn't understand it. He doesn't know he's supposed to break off his sins and righteousness until Daniel comes in and tells him, here's what this means. He has no clue what that means. He doesn't
really
know how to break off his sins.
But he's
but really, in another way, if you really want to...
Nebuchadnezzar's the wise virgins.
Yeah, or Nebuchadnezzar's the wise virgins. But the fact that he was troubled, okay, if you're going to put it in a spiritual context, the Holy Spirit is convicting him right there.
Say.
Something is wrong. I don't understand it. Something's wrong.
He knows that Daniel has the spirit of the true God in him, and he's acknowledging that, telling him, you know, because he remembered the experience that he had, you know, Daniel too. He remembers what he was told about the head.
Are we all settled on that, Brother Tyler?
I think when you look at that repeat and enlarge, you can't take them chronologically anymore. You have to relate to it as a repeat and enlarge and start it over, because you run into the issue of what we're saying right now is how can he not know what's going on, but at the same time have been rebuked and need to break off his sins by righteousness. You sort of have to separate the two thoughts. You can't look at it chronologically anymore.
But the question is, where do you start the repeat and enlarge? And that's my point. Do you start it with, okay, Nebuchadnezzar spends 12 months until he gets cut down, or do you start it with, break off your sins by righteousness, and then he spends 12 months? My question is, what gives you the license in either way to place the repeat and enlarge where it is?
Even without dealing with the repeat and enlarge, you know that 9/11, the first test is, break off your sins by righteousness.
Yeah.
It's fear God.
Is that what that phrase means?
Yeah.
I don't understand it. Probably everybody else gets it. I don't understand how we're doing that. I'm confused. About midnight, all the things we put there, it seems like they would move back to 9/11 then. He's telling him, he's interpreting it, he's saying, break off your sins in righteousness because here's the interpretation of your dream, but yet we're putting the interpretation at midnight. I'm confused.
The alternative is to put the 12 months forward from the midnight cry and the seven times, you know, between...
Over here's the seven times.
Yeah. That would be the alternative.
Would be to put the 12 months between midnight and the midnight cry.
Yeah.
That's
what
Noel did, right?
It's what?
What Noel?
Yeah. That makes more chronological sense to me.
Noel did it that way?
He had suggested it that
way. Suggested
I don't know if
he put the 1 year... from midnight to midnight cry.
Yeah.
So can we say that at this point that Nebuchadnezzar represents the Levite?
Yeah.
And then that way we...
No, we don't want to do that yet because we don't know where we're going to put it. That's
that,
getting
the
getting the cart ahead of the horses. You're arguing, now making him a Levite when we're considering the possibility that he's an 11th-hour worker until we have it settled. I wouldn't go there. So that would mean what I'm thinking about here. This would mean right here. This is the handwriting on the wall for Belshazzar, and he gets slain right there. Because these what I'm saying is chapter. If you want to understand my logic for doing that, it's at chapter 4 and 5 because Sister White says that the first king of Babylon typified the last king of Babylon, and she calls the last king of Babylon the foolish king. Therefore, that makes Nebuchadnezzar the wise king. Therefore, this is an illustration of the everlasting gospel, and maybe it can extend all the way out here to the final righteous and wicked. But what you, if you're going to put this here, then Belshazzar's feast and the handwriting on the walls got to be here. And it could be. Okay, he could be illustrating the everlasting gospel of the 11th hour workers and of the 144,000. But let's keep moving forward, knowing that we got...
I've just got a question here. Because we've been kind of looking at breaking off their sins. And I was just also considering that of what the the king was actually eating at this time, which is grass. Now, grass is also classified like a herb. And it just reminded me of Exodus 12, you know, where when they were eating of the unleavened bread, where you find the breaking off of the sin, they were also eating bitter herbs. So do they have a correlation here in a significance?
Eating bitter herbs.
I'm sure they do, but I don't know what it is. I could go with eating. You're going to say his whatever he's eating in this history is marked, but what the grass?
Exactly. That's my question now. Because it has a correlation with breaking off of sin.
I guess you could claim it's vegetarian. Yeah, but all you got is grass there, right? Are you saying grass is bitter?
It could be classified as a bitter experience.
But grass isn't bitter, isn't it? Is it? You've all chewed a piece of grass before, right? She's making a case of bitter herbs or the cleansing herbs. You might not be familiar with that.
I just wonder exactly an example of the Mara vision.
Not enough information. Brother Rick, you want to do 5 verses? I can't believe we're not going to get through chapter 4 again.
While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven, saying, O king Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee, and they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field. They shall make thee to eat grass as oxen, and 7 times shall pass over thee, until thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men, and giveth it to whomsoever he will. The same hour was the thing fulfilled from Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from men, and did eat grass as oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his hairs were grown like eagle's feathers, and his nails like birds' claws. And at the end of days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up my eyes into heaven, and mine understanding returned unto me, and I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored him that liveth forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. And all the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing, and he doeth according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and none can stay his hand or say unto him, What doest thou?
Okay, we didn't deal with verse 30, but there is an inquiry in verse 30, right? Mm-hmm. And that inquiry marks where he's cut down. So I'm putting that inquiry right there. Is this not great Babylon that I have built? Okay, verse 31.
Voice from heaven.
A voice from heaven. We already have that. Okay, up here, the Holy One. So it's a second witness to that. What else?
Departed.
The kingdom is departed.
The same
hour. The Sunday law.
In the same hour, the king was fulfilled.
The perfect departing.
The 1 hour.
The
kingdom departed.
Seems like it fits better if you move everything down.
But that's the fractal
move,
of
move
the Sunday
everything
law.
Down what?
She's saying the Sunday law.
Okay, let's start with this one so we can dead end that thought. Where does it say? Verse 34. The end of the days. Right?
Yeah.
Go to Daniel 12:13. Daniel 12:13. Daniel 12:13 says, But go thy way till the end be, for thou shalt rest and stand in thy lot at the end of the days. What's pioneer understanding of the end of the days there in verse 13?
October 22nd, 1844.
October 22nd, 1844. And October 22nd, 1844 typifies what?
Both the Sunday law and the
Sunday. No, don't confuse it. It's there. Okay, so even if you want to put it down here like Michael's arguing, and you're going to extend this over, you still got justification for right here. End of the days. And what's going to happen at the end of the days for Belshazzar is that Cyrus is going to come through the gate that no man can open, and he's going to illustrate the work of Christ moving from the holy place to the most holy place on this very way mark. So this is, you've got strong arguments that this is the everlasting gospel, and it gets fulfilled here. Maybe it gets fulfilled here too, but we have to figure out how to put this in place at one level where it ends here, which means you don't do it chronologically. You can, I guess, if you're going to take the end of the days to the close of probation and deal with the 11th hour workers, but
they were gathered at the end of the 2520 and restored.
Probably.
And the other 2520 of Belshazzar represents the other the ten tribes that were never gathered.
But what's that got to do with these verses? How's that breaking down these verses, going to the 2520s?
Well, we know that at the end of the seven times of Nebuchadnezzar, he was gathered in and he praised God, and he was humbled to the ground, and he basically praised God of heaven. To Belshazzar, what he did in his feast, he actually praised the gods of gold and of silver. He ended up praising different gods, never humbled him. It was a shut door for Belshazzar, but it was an open door for Nebuchadnezzar.
Mm-hmm. But that's something we teach all of you for you.
Right, but I'm just saying that the application that we're doing. Okay. We're dealing with the wise and we're dealing with the foolish.
Verse 31. While the word was in the king's mouth.
That would be me.
That would be what?
Sorry.
Verse 31, no, I'm wanting to know, we've already read it. What's it mean that the word was in the king's mouth?
Speaking.
Okay, his kingdom's departed when the word's in his mouth. What kingdom departed? What's his word?
A decree.
Some kind of decree? He speaks. When he speaks this Sunday law, his kingdom's departed.
The same, like, isn't this what this is saying? Is in verse 30, the king was speaking about how great his kingdom is.
Yeah.
So while the word
of verse 30
of boasting is still in his mouth, so is that still a decree though? Because he's proud about his kingdom.
Well, there is a decree here.
I know.
Okay, and the speaking of a nation is an action of his legislative and judicial authority. So while he's passing this decree, mm-hmm. his probation closes. And we know for certain, we got Spirit of Prophecy quotes it. So when they pass the Sunday law, national apostasy is followed by national ruin, and that this is the end of the sixth kingdom, the beginning of the seventh. So we know that when they speak that decree at the Sunday law, their kingdom's departed. So at the fractal level, we're seeing evidence there's something else here about a kingdom departing right in their action of the sun of that first Sunday law decree.
Have we ever shown that before? I know we show the two horns falling, one in the Millerite history and one in our history, but it's usually at 9/11 and
no.
So where are we showing the falling?
What are we showing about the falling? What do we know about the falling from Manasseh?
It's progressive.
It's progressive. Okay, so there's
really specific there, though.
Speaking is a dragon here. There's some kind of speaking that removes their kingdom here, and a speaking here that totally removes their kingdom. What would that be?
Progression.
Going into the kingdom. Balaam.
Or they're not decree, though. That's Islam, I guess.
Okay.
It's a progressive fall.
What horns conquered here?
Republicanism.
Republicanism. But it's still a progressive fall, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it's still republicanism. They've been conquered here in terms of April 19th, 1844. The Protestant horns fallen on the first day of the first month. So the Republican horn is falling. What happens here? What is this history? The image of the beast test. And what is the image of the beast? There's only one definition. It's a combination of church and state with the church in control of the relationship. Right here is where the church in the United States takes the ascendancy over the republicanism in the United States. That republican kingdom falls right here as the church takes control. That is the image of the beast. So when the Protestant churches can take control and direct the political structure in order to implement their dogmas and teachings, that's probably the kingdom departed, is republicanism being conquered by the Protestant horn that comes up last.
So that's the fulfillment then at the midnight cry of that horn being conquered. The progression ends at the midnight cry. And then you've got the image of the beast set up, and then at the Sunday law you've got the seventh kingdom taking over the UN.
Works for me.
I like it too.
You like it too, all right? Testimony of two sounds... Is everyone seeing that? There has to be a kingdom that departs here. And horns are kings. But the United States has two kings. It's got the Medes and the Persians. But it's falling here, the Republican horn. But here's where they turn their structure over.
We're not marking the Protestant horn there. We're just marking that there is a ascendancy of the false prophets.
There's a heart change.
There's a heart change. Oh.
Yeah, there's a heart change.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You're right.
So then Islam and the crisis needs to happen at midnight.
Yeah.
Say that again, sorry.
So is the crisis of Islam has to happen at midnight.
Because that's the only way that that's going to happen.
Yeah.
It's the only way that that's going to happen. There has to be something here that creates the environment to start the image of the beast testing.
Yeah.
Yeah, we have other... You guys wouldn't let me put that for Islam here, but we have other references to Islam at midnight. Yes?
I think we do.
Okay. Well, that question will be on your final test.
I think you just kind of covered it also, just in brief, when we were talking about the enemies, and that the enemy is also a symbol of Islam as well.
Yeah, they're probably the primary enemy of the United States right now. Like, this dream is about, it's for your enemies. They're going to love this one. But let's read on, or make sure we work through these verses.
I got one other question here. When it was talking about in verse 24, just going back again, the decree of the Most High, so would that then be the prediction that God is giving? Or what would that be? Because it's actually a decree that comes from God. And then where we find it also in 31, we find the fulfillment of that decree, where the kingdom is then departed. Would that then be a prediction fulfilled?
I don't know the distinction between the decrees. I don't know. Sister White says every nation's given a time of probationary time, and that might be a decree, and he's reached the end of his probationary time. Verse 33, the same hour the thing was fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar. When's the thing fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar?
Midnight cry. So that's an hour.
What gets fulfilled? So this is an hour.
Yeah, because it says the same hour, so you got to assume that's an hour.
The seven times is an hour, because it's fulfilled on Nebuchadnezzar, and he's going to be eating grass for 2,520 days, right? So this is an hour, and this is an hour, and this is a binding off, and this is a binding off. An hour is a binding off, and this is the hour that is the binding off of the 11th hour worker. At the end of the days... Verse 36 and 37 says, at the same time my reason returned to me, and for the glory of my kingdom mine honor and brightness returned unto me. and my counselors and my lord sought unto me, and I was established in my kingdom, and excellent majesty was added unto me. Now I, Nebuchadnezzar, praise and extol and honor the King of Heaven, all whose words are truth, and his ways are judgment.
Works.
His ways, with all whose works are truth, and his ways are judgment, and those that walk in pride, he is able to abase. I don't know what this means necessarily, but his reason returns. He kind of switches gears here, whoever he is, right?
He's representing two classes at the same time.
Yeah, or maybe more.
Or, yeah.
Yeah, more. Wise and foolish virgins, but also the United States.
Because there's people in the United States with the Sunday law that are going to get their reason back and realize that going along with the ecumenical.
Yeah, if you're
going to
extend this out, that would fit perfectly. Here's where their reason is returning after they've looked at this history.
Yeah.
Now that we've made it through the chapter, I think we can. There's a verse that can help us to maybe extend it out also to show it at that other level, where the 1 year is between midnight cry and Sunday law, and seven times is from the Sunday law to the close of probation. And the verse is 1 Samuel 15:28. When you're relating to the seven times following the Sunday law, it would be like the number seven in the reform line that comes after the shut door. So you can already see a number seven there in that history. But 1 Samuel 15:28, it says that, we'll read it. And Samuel said unto him, the Lord hath rent the kingdom from Israel.
Of Israel.
Of Israel, from thee this day, and hath given it to a neighbor of thine that is better than you. So there's two things here that are interesting. I think that one, it's renting the kingdom is the same as the kingdom departing. I think it's the kingdom is taken from one individual and given to another. And the what it ties into is Esther 1:19, where it says that Vashti is taken from the kingdom and replaced with one who's better than her. So Vashti helps us to kind of place that at the Sunday law, where that kingdom is being taken from her. And anyways, that was my point. Maybe you can see it at that other level as well.
Kingdom departed here.
Yeah.
And who's he giving it to?
The other.
He's taking it from Saul and giving it to him.
David.
Yeah. Okay, so where's David's kingdom? Where's David's kingdom established? I don't know if that's the right word, because we use it. It's right here, right? Church triumphant. He's here. He's going all through here. But church triumphant. Tyler?
Also another witness to the rending of the kingdom is Ezekiel 29:15. And this is the prophecy against Pharaoh. And it says, and it shall be the basest of kingdoms, neither shall it exalt itself any more above the nations, for I will diminish them, that they shall no more rule over the nations. And you'd have to read more about under the context. That's the United States being diminished at the Sunday law becomes the basest of nations.
So it would be, it's Egypt.
Yeah, it's Egypt.
Egypt, when you're looking at Sodom and Egypt and France typifying the United States, Sodom is the church, Egypt is the political structure. So Egypt's kingdom is being departed here too. And given to who in the passage? He's going to become the basis of kingdoms, and it's given to Babylon.
Nebuchadnezzar.
And that's Deuteronomy 28. It talks about the fruit of your land goes to a nation, another nation. The same thing is given to Babylon.
All right.
Yep.
Tomorrow we start through chapter 5.
Three.
And try to get the second witness to this history, and then chapter 6, and then we erase the alignment.
Can I read something real quick from Rivian Herald about Nebuchadnezzar? It says here that when Nebuchadnezzar, it says, as the king gazed upon the lofty tree, he beheld a watcher, even a holy one, a divine messenger, similar in appearance to the one who walked in the three Hebrews in the fiery furnace. So, you know, we were talking earlier whether Nebuchadnezzar had any knowledge about what happened before. He did, because he assembled the Holy One that he was seeing in his dream with what happened in Daniel 3.
He recognized that guy in his dream.
Yeah, so he had knowledge.
Okay, when this class breaks, before everyone leaves, we need Gabriel here, Tyler, Michael, Jason, Bronwyn, Kathy, Arian. And that's it. Is there any other kind of business we need to handle this morning before we part ways? Pardon me? Okay. So, it's Igor, right?
Yeah.
Alright, will you pray for us?
Sure. Dear God, thank you for the blessed night. Thank you for the study that we just had. Bless us. Stay with us during the day. Watch us. Help us during the whole week. It's just starting. Guide us through our problems. Help us study. Keep us humble. I praise thee. In the name of Jesus, amen.